task is to give you a little bit of the history of now. How did we get here? Why is this D&C Days different than some of the others? Let's take a step back for a moment to 2015. Everyone here has probably heard of the Paris Agreement. What made the Paris Agreement different from the other bits of UNFCCC language that we've seen? One of the shifts was going from a goal about emissions to saying a temperature. You know, what is the definition of dangerous climate change? And we said 2 degrees, and let's really try to stay well below that. Could we get to 1.5? Well, what does that really mean? Does 0.5 degree of global average make that much of a difference? And quite frankly, nobody had a clear, concise answer for that. So what does the party do in UNFCCC? You turn to IPCC, and you say, could you, as the scientific community, tell us this? Now that's really important in two ways. One is it actually sends a signal to the research community, and IDRC, and the program I've led over the past number of years, the Collaborative Adaptation Research Initiative in Africa and Asia, heard that and went, this is a fantastic opportunity. And the IPCC puts out a like that thing that says, if you get something submitted or published by this date, we'll look at it. So that puts the fire under us to be able to say, okay, what is the novel evidence? What is the insight we can bring to something like this? And let's just take a step back for a moment. What is a global average? Now you may remember your math classes, an average, well that's sort of like the middle number in a range of things. So when you see an increase of 0.5 or 1 degree, this isn't just shifting that much in one day, that's shifting the entire curve. And you end up with a thickening of what are the possible outliers? And that's really interesting in terms of what are some of the extreme events, higher temperatures that are going on. So we knew this intuitively, but what was the science telling us? And we'll hear more about that in a little bit, but this was the call that we tried to answer. I'm going to start with what my program and the 400 researchers we've been working with were able to crystallize over the past little while. And it actually is quite concerning. So if we just look at climatic hotspots. What are some of those locations we already know have a significant climate signal and are homes to significant populations of poor and vulnerable people? Well, we know, for example, now that in the Hindu Kush Himalaya region, that under a 1.5 scenario, over one quarter of the ice in those glaciers will disappear. And under a 2-degree scenario, about half. Now, what are the implications for 1/7 of humanity that lives downstream and depends on those basins with their water security? We now know that in semi-arid lands, the variation in rainfall is going to continue getting more erratic. What does that mean then for power production, agriculture, human health? Those implications are very real and in many ways are already being felt. Let's take Botswana, for example. We know now, with this call to action to do the research, and we've done the research, that under a 1.5 scenario, there'll be 10 more hot days per year. And if we actually end up in 2 degrees, it'll be 17 more hot days. Maize yields will go down by 20% under 1.5, or 36% under a 2-degree scenario. Number of hot days where people are exposed to heat stress will be 20 more hot days under a 1.5 scenario, or 40 under a 2-degree scenario. So you're starting to see that this half a degree matters. What we tend to sort of disregard when we look at the weather forecast on a day-to-day basis makes a humongous change when you're talking about a global average temperature change in terms of future climates. Because what that really brings together is some of those extremes, the thickening of the tails of the distribution curve. And think of that, not just the average, if you will. We know that deltas, it's a little bit slower, the onset there. We're probably not going to have measurable increase in sea level 2040s. But then look at it. Under 1.5 scenario, we'd be looking at 2.5 times the amount of land area that would be subject to flooding. So these are some of the findings we were able to contribute to the IPCC, who then had to look over 6,000 different other publications and insights to come together with their census report. And we'll hear a bit more about that later, but I just wanted to recount what I experienced both last month and this week. So we saw the report come out, and it has generated a tremendous amount of media. And this week, in a plenary session at the COP, 3 hours of going through chapter by chapter, and you could almost hear a pin drop. There were thousands of people in a very quiet room, and everyone was just like, whoa. So this matters. I mean, we know now that we're at a very critical time. Depending on what you're looking at in terms of the thresholds, we're looking at 2030 to 2040 in terms of reaching this scenario. And we know that because of the distribution curve, there are places in the world that are already experiencing greater than 1.5. I mentioned the Hindu-Kush Himalayas earlier. A 1.5 global average is felt as in excess of 2 degrees there. 2-degree increase would be the equivalent of 2.7. You look at the IPCC's report, and my own home in Canada is essentially a hotspot. The warming in the Canadian Arctic is greater than that average. And if you've built your schools and roads with ice and permafrost, and that's turning into mud, that makes a humongous difference. My society is going to have to adapt. This isn't just about Africa and Asia. So what I wanted to highlight is that we're now seeing the beginning of mini conversations and the end of my notes. So I'm going to add a little bit from here. That we're now asking ourselves, so what was in that report? What does it mean for you? What does it mean for me? What does it mean for our communities, our homes, our futures, and our nows? And what we would like to do now is bring you into just one of those conversations that's happening, and then invite you to be joining this conversation. Thank you.